Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. It could be 1876, it could be 2018. What cannot be disputed, however, is that that is an elephant, and you are on a live safari from the middle of the Sabi Sand Game Reserve. That is a spit of land on the far side of the Kruger National Park, an iconic space. 8.5 million acres of untrammeled wildlife wilderness wonderland. That's a triple alliteration, David. My name is James Hendry. On camera today is David. Yes, did you see how I delayed that? Very funny. And by First Officer C. Byrne of Vermont, United States, America. And on walk today, I was just wondering who else was going to be talking to you. A rare pleasure, of course. We're being spoken to by Stefan Winterboer, and he is being ably assisted by Brian the Giraffe Schubert, and of course Herbert the Tracker with his very thin moustache. And it's very good to have him along as well. Please do talk to us during the course of the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live or questions@wildearth.tv are the best ways to get hold of us. Now, my plan for the afternoon is to double cub it, and if not possible, them. We're then going to the hyena cubs. We'll definitely find them too. Then we're going to go to Karula and her cubs, and then we'll go home and have a drink to celebrate. So that's the plan for the afternoon. You'll probably find, actually, because of the plan I've just made, that these will be the last animals we see. Anyway, there they are. A lovely herd of elephants here on the Gari cut line. You're most welcome. It's good to have you with us, and let's enjoy the wonders of this beautiful winter's afternoon. It's 26 degrees Celsius, and that's not a bad temperature for midwinter, I don't think. Not many parts of the world you can call midwinter 78 degrees Celsius. And the peace of the midday still envelops us. Now, David, there's something that sounds like a police siren behind us. Given our proximity to the going, choo, choo, choo. And I don't know what it is. You hear it? I think it might be a slightly hoarse grey go-away bird. Yes, it is. In fact, I've just seen one fly in there. Grey go-away bird, everybody, with a slight laryngitis. Including the grey go-away bird. Let's get another look at these elephants, and then we'll start with the first of our cubs. Now, for those of you who think I'm actually going to show you three sets of cubs this afternoon, just be aware that I am being extremely fanciful. The possibility is there, the chances are probably less than 2%. That's not very good chances. There's one. Thicket. And they're probably going to fetch up. If you keep an eye on the Juma Dam cam, you'll probably find that they'll fetch up there sometime fairly soon. That's just across in a westerly direction from where that little elephant is feeding. We're going to go this way. We were drawn this way by the elephants, and they're somewhere in the next drainage line, we hope. While we go and look, let's head across to Stefan the Mystic Winterboer and find out what his plans for the afternoon are.
No, it's not an elephant. It's a massive marula tree. Let me get out of the shot there. I don't want to steal its limelight. All right, now we've decided to put our nose into the wind this morning, or this afternoon, and we have walked west out of the camp with our goal to sort of walk west and then angle south, because that was the last place that Karula's tracks went into. And although we expected her tracks to cross out on Gari Main, her tracks haven't come out anywhere. They didn't come out at Treehouse, they didn't come out on it's the crest that separates the river that flows past Juma from the Manuleti. which is another river on the other side. So it's a bit of a watershed as well as a crest. Nice high ground, lots of thickets of strychnos, and a place where a lot of the grazers live. I'm going to prove it to you just by having a look around over here. You can see that although not a lot, there is a lot more grass cover where we're standing than other places on the reserve. Now we are, one of the huge pluses about the Sabi Sands, of course, and that's where we are, is the marula trees that we have on this particular property. They grow to enormous lengths. And while Brian just tries and gets this particular one in frame for you, I'll give it some relevance by showing you exactly how big this trunk is. Now, walking up to this tree to decide exactly what it is. Now, I don't quite know. I'm seeing that we've got some termite activity and the bark looks like it's split underneath this particular bough over here, that the thick branches have fallen off. And I don't quite know if it's an old tree that has been fire damaged or if it's a fungal disease. So what I'm going to do is follow one of these lines over here. Now, this will give you an idea. The bark of a tree, quite honestly, is its armor. And the tree will shed its bark. As you can see over here, it's a piece of, a chunk of bark has come off. Our skin does. But quite often what that does is it leaves the tree vulnerable. And you'll get a woodpecker, you'll get some fungus, or you'll get an insect that decides to bore in through this particular foot of the tree. And come and have a look down here, because we've got a hole here. And while I'm definitely not one to stick my face into every single of now, what's happened, this tree has had a, or it's a vulnerable point. And now something has moved in there, but that's also allowed fungus and probably termites to infiltrate the core of the tree. Now, the core of the tree doesn't transport any nutrients. It's just there to give the sunlight, and that's why trees get big. But it has let some termites in, and you can see over here, you can see, I actually found them. There one goes there. Let's see. There we go. Now they're white because there's an orange one, a soldier. They're white because they don't contain any melanin. Sun, these don't have melanin. And for that reason, they are white or bleached. And now they are busy eating. There's one there. They are busy eating this tree literally from the inside out. And that is what I think has damaged this tree, is we see now. Abhishek has just asked me if there's any medicinal uses for marula trees. Absolutely, Abhishek. These trees are widely used in a lot of different treatments. Settlers use them for the fruit. The fruit can be fermented into a beer, and that is obviously something to let the good times roll. So a bit of a psycho benefit. I don't know what else to call it, some good medicine. But the bark is also used. You can peel open this bark. Let me show you now. I don't think I'm going to be doing any more damage to this tree, but let me see. Is full of tannin. Now, tannin was used to tan leather. So this strips of bark would have been boiled in pots of water, and leather would have been left to soak in it, which would have softened the collagen in the leather and given you softer leather. But we also use it on poultices. Tannin stops bleeding quite a lot. So you can use the inside bark of a marula tree, you can squeeze out the juice and vessels in it, and it helps to stop bleeding. But anyway, this is my big marula tree. I hope you enjoyed it with me. We're going to carry on and look for any more signs of Karula, not marula, and we're going to send you over to James, who's got an update for you. Catch you later.
Right, we're not yet, it was driving out of where Taylor thought it might be a leopard. So we're going to look into all of the trees to see if there isn't a dangling warthog or some such, because we haven't seen Tingana for a while. I'm absolutely sure that he's fine. And I saw a picture of him that someone posted of him on Elephant Plains recently, which is an oddly far west of him to be. A query from Londolozi today just asking for some information on Kunyuma, because he seems to have taken up residence there and he seems to be forging himself a territory already. Now, he is 3.5 years old, and that is very young to be taking a territory. And he was quite an aggressive little fellow, we know that. Or sort of not aggressive, but he was, he was prone to easily irritating. And maybe that has helped him to forge his way down there. It was called the Dudley Riverbank Mail, and he died. And now Kunyuma seems to be taking on that little part of the territory that is on the Sand River, which I think is very nice for him. So I thought those of you who know him would be quite interested in that. And his brother, quite possibly because there are no other male leopards there. Other than his father, who used to traverse down there, and still does a little bit, but old Mvula is now nomadic. He's not holding territory anymore. He might again, but I think it's unlikely. Now, we are into the area where the cubbies might be, so anywhere around here, our first set of cubs of three. Good question. Debbie in Vancouver, you say, how do antelope react or animals react when they see 5-month-old cubs? I'm assuming you're talking about Karula's cubs who are just over 5 months old. Debbie, there's a huge, huge giraffe. It's very nice to see. Debbie, I don't think that they will alarm call at baby leopards, but birds do. Birds absolutely will shout at baby leopards. And while the antelope will be very weary of where mother is, I don't think that I've ever heard. Now, while you look at the giraffe, I'm staring up the drainage to see if I can't find evidence of lions. Apparently, your lion cub sighting today was just the most spectacular. And if you weren't on drive this morning, and I know with your daylight savings is a bit of a nightmare, but they were three of them and suspected a whole lot more younger ones not too far from here, just up to the west of Biffle's Hook Dam. I do see the oxpecker, David. Thank you, David, or were you just... Very small. No, I think it's just hiding behind the central ossicone there. Standard issue oxpecker, red billed. I thought it might be a yellow billed, but it isn't. Now, a juvenile oxpecker, of course, has got no red bill. It's got a purely brown bill. You can see very well-developed third horn or median horn, if you like. That's that calcification of the skull there. So he's a weathered old fellow, and he's had many fights in his time. I think, looking in far better condition than the grazers at this stage. There's far more to eat if you're a browser than if you're a grazer. Alrighty, let's move on up the drainage line here and see if we are very lucky. Signal might be a little bit dodgy in here, everybody. And so while we go through this area, Steph, with his amazing eyes, combined with Herbert's amazing eyes, has found you a spider.
World. This is the land mammal equivalent of a Bengal tiger, an African male lion, a great white shark, a king cobra, killer whale, polar bear. This is the terror and nemesis of most insects out here. This is a Portia jumping spider, and she hunts other spiders. She actually will kill almost anything she can overpower, but her predominant prey are other spiders, and she can learn to hunt different spiders in different environments because that whole cephalothorax, which is the head part of the spider, And I'm just going to twist her slowly so that you can see the top of the head. There we go. The whole part of that head is filled with brain. She has the largest brain weight to body mass ratio of any insect in the world, and is therefore the most intelligent insect on the planet. We're just going to turn her. Let me just get her into the sun. There you go. Have a look at those two eyes that are facing you there. That's to give her binocular vision, as the name would sit in an area and catch prey. She also has two other eyes on top of her head, and I'm going to try and turn this a little bit so that you can see if you can see the eyes on top of her head. Let's turn her like this. She's obviously can see. They're not dangerous to people. Whoop! She's on the lens. That is incredible. She's now, let me just see if I can get her. Come here, little girl. Come on. We're going to bring her into shot now. She's on the lens now. You're going to have her walking across the front of your screen now. She's going to bite Brian's finger. All right, hang on, wait. Hold on 2 seconds for me. While you're looking into my face over here, I'm going to try and push her out. There we go. It's like watching someone perform an operation, a very delicate operation. Please note my funny facial expressions. And I have a habit of sticking my tongue out when I'm concentrating. Come now. There you go. Yeah. Don't worry, curious one. I'm also glad that this spider isn't as big as a tiger. Although, believe me, it might get a bit dark. That's my stick in place of my finger. Come now. Oh, not good. She's covered in these hairs. I don't want to make Brian nervous. So what I'm going to say is the spider's... Come on. There you go. There's Brian. He's just making sure that I'm not playing too much with the spider. Going to bite him on the finger. Come on, girl. There you go. There you go. Come along. We actually found her blowing in the breeze. Now, funnily enough, what happened to her is she bumped. She must have jumped off from one stick to another and missed the branch that the wind was blowing her, blowing silk out of her, and then she'd reel it in a little bit like a fisherman reeling in his line, and then the wind would blow it and she'd go out again. So we actually saved her, to be quite honest. Where's she now, Brian? Yeah, we got her. Brian's got her by the thumb. She's saying hello, making introductions. My favorite species of spider is the jumping spiders, and of course they're also one of the most numerous because they hunt other spiders. Ah, oh, Brian's got him. There you go. Brian's very brave. All right, let's see if we can get onto the stick here. There you go, come on. There. All righty, we're going to put her back in the tree. You can see that she's going to be very safe. Let's see if she'll make another spectacular jump for you. Let's see if we can get... Come on. Come on. Let's see if she'll jump. Come on. Come on, you guys, you guys. Almost ready, almost ready. Let me take her a bit closer. Still not. Come now, girl, you can do it. There you go. Now she jumps by pumping fluid. There we go, you got it. Well done. Not every day you get to see a Porsche jumping spider jump. On that note, we're going to send you over to James. He's approaching Buffalsick Dam.
Yes, I am approaching. I have approached, and I'm now static here at Biffleshook Dam, slightly disappointed because we didn't come across any lion cubs on the way here. We are going to go and have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of them. And they are just lurking about here, indicating that there are no lions about right now. One of them has a very snoggy nose. That one there. Fortunately, he's got a cold. You can see that lovely sight of his mucus dripping to the ground. And then to the right of him, one of them has rabies. See, he's foaming at the mouth, David. That is not rabies. I'm being entirely facetious, everyone. All it is the fact that he is grinding all the time, and that's disgusting. And then to the left of that, and left again, there, will you just super zoom on that oxpecker? But I'm in the middle of the body. That's it, yes. I believe it. It is. It's a yellow-billed oxpecker, everyone. is it? Low eye. It is a digging into the side of the flesh of the buffalo, which can't feel too nice. I don't think it's sort of ticklish, but it doesn't seem to be incurring the buffalo's wrath at all. And this is where the thought that oxpeckers are not, in fact, flu. They keep these wounds open. Now, while that might have a slightly cleansing effect on the buffalo's wound, it definitely keeps them open. And, of course, the reason you have skin on your body is so that your blood and flesh is not exposed to the elements. And the oxpecker is not helping that situation here, loving eating the fresh red blood straight out of the buffalo, as opposed to having to ingest it through the medium of an, where, although peace reigns supreme, there is quite a lot of activity. There is a hippopotamus, Bob, the bachelor of Biffle's Hook, is taking up his natural winter position here at Biffle's Hook Dam. You can see he is completely at peace. His eyes are semi-closed. He's just keeping an eye out for any intruders that might come along here and disturb him in his dam. Really suboptimal hippo. And then, I think the highlight of this Biffle's Hook experience, there is a massive serrated hinged terrapin. Look at him. Ba-pow. There we go. Isn't that amazing? And he's just lurking there, loving the sun. He's a reptile, so he's obviously out of the mud, actually, and got him sitting in the sun, warming his blood so that he can have a swim around and see if he can't find something to eat, something in the way of algae or other kinds of insects that might come out as well into the water. Isn't that nice? This is why we describe estivation and not hibernation. Remember, and it's largely to do with the dryness of the landscape, and it is quite dry, but at the same time, as soon as conditions are favourable, animals come out of that sort of temporary state of estivation, and they start actually doing some work. They get on with a few activities. So that terrapin, because there's a bit of water and there's a bit of heat, we'll now go and see if it can find something here at Biffle's Hook Dam. Excuse me. My lunch seems to have made a little bit of gas in my belly, everybody. It keeps coming out. Sorry about that. Now let me just drive along here and we'll stop briefly again and have a look at this terrapin. E07. I hope your mother didn't call you that, and if she did, I hope you're not friends with her anymore. Elic 07, you want to know if that is a turtle? It is not a turtle, but it is related to a turtle. It's called a terrapin. And a terrapin is a freshwater version of a turtle. Now, I mean, I think a lot of this is kind of semantics. In the States, if I'm not mistaken, just about anything with a shell on the bottom of it is, or on the top of it, is called a turtle. In reality, a turtle is a sea-dwelling, what we call chelonian, and a chelonian is a reptile with a shell on it. And so in the States, often, you know, all chelonians are known as turtles. You'd call a turtle only the sea-dwelling, salt-water-dwelling chelonians, and they, of course, have to cope with much colder conditions than these ones because they're in the sea most of the time. They're in the water all the time, and they breathe. Remember, they don't breathe underwater. They're just like us, and dolphins and whales. They have to come to the surface to breathe, but they can hold their breath for a very long time. And then you get tortoises. They can avoid it. Well, they do. They go in and they have a drink, and sometimes they lie in the water. But they don't swim like turtles and terrapins. Thank you, Elic 70, or 07, sorry. An opportune moment to tell you a folk tale about hippopotamus. You say, do hippo eat catfish? The answer is no, Wayne, and the reason they don't, of course, is because, as far as I remember, what happened was that they used to live outside the water. But it was there, and so the hippo befell on the good Lord and said unto him, mayest I go into the water to dwell? And the Lord doth spake unto the hippopotamus, yes, but thou must not eat mine catfish. And the hippo said, okay. And the Lord said, well, how will you show me that you are not eating my catfish? And the hippo spake unto the Lord, I shall spray my dung all over the bushes. And that, everybody, is why, apparently, the hippopotamus sprays his dung all over the bushes with thou. And that, basically, is the folktale of why the hippopotamus lives in the water. So, it doesn't eat catfish. That's obviously not why it doesn't eat catfish. It is a herbivore. It's a herbivore completely, and it only eats, it eats a little bit of water vegetation, but it actually does extremely little feeding in the water. Good rainy year, and if you go onto the banks of a river in an area like this, you find these huge lawns that have been cropped really nice and short. They look like the sort of first fairway at Augusta, and they are maintained by the hippo, who keep these grazing lawns. Of course, it's difficult to find them now because there's no grazing lawns around because there's so little grass, except in desperate times. And there is certainly, there are records of them killing sometimes things like springbok and animals that have been injured by crocodiles. Thank you very much for that question. I think I probably need to work on my folk tale there, don't you think, David?
Maybe, Jim.
In on the terrapin's tracks. Well, we can try. I don't know if those are terrapin tracks that are just behind there. Let me just get my binoculars. You see that bits of mud there behind the terrapin there, David?
Yeah.
Ah, I can see some terrapin tracks. Yeah, hang on a sec. Left a bit more. There. See that track there? That's the terrapin tracks there, James Richard, but they're not... they're not very well defined. We really need to find them in some sort of clayey sand, rather without the water, and then you'll get an idea of what the tracks really look like. Cross to a hymenopterid with Steph.
Welcome back to a bit of a phenomenon we're doing. I have an idea about what they're doing. Now, if you have a careful look at these ants, you'll notice that some of them scurry about with their tails cocked. There's one then near the center of your screen. And that is called, or these aphids, they herd them together from all over a plant, and these aphids suck sap. And what the ants do is they tickle the aphid, which then releases a bit of sap called honeydew. And the ants then either their stings out on their tails, or they themselves are exuding some or other type of, I don't know what you'd call it. But have a look at all these ants now. Now, ants too, and these particular cocktail ants sting. Not quite as bad as a bee, but definitely bad enough that you don't want to stick your hands in there. That's not what you want to do. And the ants get honeydew. There's a little dark round type of aphid beetle thingy that then you can see every time they go past one, they tickle it with the feelers, and some of them are sucking up. It's actually quite nutrient poor. And so what happens is that the aphids suck in a lot of sap to get the nutrients that they need, but they don't want to get too big. So they exude a lot of sap out the other side, this honeydew. Here we have, I think, cocktail ants farming their aphids. However, what is astounding for me is the fact that some of them seem to be, you know what that is? So an unanswered question, which seems to be the hallmark of a lot of these walks that I end up doing, is a lot of these trees actually provide a home for these ants. So they'll not only provide the sap for the, they not only provide the sap that the ants like to eat, but they will also provide, there's their nest inside there. So they're living inside this dried up twig. Now, James Duggan, good afternoon, James. You've asked me, do we get ant migrations here similar to the ones in the Amazon? James, because the insects in the rainforest are so large, you do get much larger migrations of ants than you do here. But to answer your question simply, yes, we absolutely do get migrations of ants here. Ants will move their colonies every few days to every few days. Are the Matabele ants. The Matabele ants are termite raiders. They raid termite colonies. They move their colonies, their whole gallery, 600 to 800 individuals. They move every couple of days. They move into an area, raid the termites. The termites block up their holes, their source of food dries up, and then they move the colony again. And we quite often see these processions, a couple of meters in length, of Matabele ants out here, a couple of meters. The biggest migrations that we get close to South Africa are those of the East African army ant, or the Siafu ant. There you can get up to a couple of hundred meters, and they've got a fearsome reputation for denuding the bush all over the place of anything. And then of course, exactly what they are, but even in North America, you get the wood ant, I think, and then you get the leaf cutter ant in the forest. You get a bunch of different types of ants in the rainforests that do move when they've cleaned an area of either vegetation or insect food. Nothing to that scale here, unfortunately. Although I must be honest, with the zoom lens that we have on these cameras, small things become large things very easily. Easily turning a microscopic ant into something as big as a leopard. We've come through this. Karen, good evening, Karen. You must be watching very late. You're all the way from Australia. If you are talking about the huntsman spider specific to Australia that is so venomous, then no, we don't get that particular one. Our huntsman spiders here are called lynx spiders. Lynx spiders are a fairly large group of spider habitats, quite often carrying their egg sacs underneath their bodies. If I have it correctly, my memory, a huntsman spider, but definitely not the venomous one that you have on that side. Our venomous spiders here are the sac spider, the violin spider, the black button or black recluse spider, and the six-eyed desert crab spider. Nowhere near as deadly as the ones that you have all the way in Australia. Now, Wesley, you've just asked me a question. Will all these ants, Kirsty, to repeat that again? Antelope. I have absolutely no idea what that is all about. So sorry. I can't answer your question there, Wesley. Oh, will they go into the antelope? Gee whiz, sorry, Wesley. It's my dummy ear. It's too much rifle practicing when I was younger. Would ants go onto antelope, similar to oxpeckers do to clean off ticks? No, not onto antelope, but definitely onto birds. So birds have a behavior called anting. And what the birds will do is they go and lie on the bird's skin, and then the bird shakes its feathers. And what that does is cause the ants to have a bit of a freak out. And they go, whoa! And quite often, ants can spray out formic acid. The ants then spray out this formic acid as a defense. That formic acid goes onto the skin of the bird and is repellent to mites and parasites on that skin, on the skin of that bird, isn't it? Then rubs and sandbaths the mites that have now come to the outside of the feathers to escape the formic acid, along with the ants off, and they fly off having a bath, called anting, that particular phenomenon. So eventually it led to quite a nice response there, Wesley. Excuse me for not catching that. All right. Of gaining a little bit of height. And it also allows us to have a nice view of the bush. I have a friend of mine, a dear friend of mine, who walked on top of a termite mound and ended up walking onto a Mozambican spitting cobra. How's that for a horrifying name? That was basking in the sun on top of a termite mound. And so although I love climbing up termite mounds, I normally always stop at the crest just before standing on it and look at cobras lying about. Now, of course, the chances of there being one are quite slim, to be quite honest with you. I think my friend Simon was just unlucky on that particular day. All right. We're coming out. It's quite interesting when you're standing up here, right? Is that you can see different types of vegetation. We've got quite obvious a band of trees in front of us that starts almost as if a line was drawn in the sand. Watch the show quite often. We'll stop quite often in the terminalias and talk about silver cluster leaves. Their wood is very resilient. It's also resilient to termites. It's hard. and is used quite often in fencing posts or in roof struts or in farm implement handles, so things like spades and pickaxe handles. Tells me that it's a good place there to find some water. Those trees are very good indicators of water. And how you'd find water is you'd walk into a band of those trees, downslope, and when those trees end on the downslope side, is quite a good place to start looking for water. And water plants, little springs, mud wallows, copses of flowers, and of course my favorite, everything that is associated with all of those things, all the creepy crawlies that go with all of that stuff. So I think what we do, be anything now, we're in the grips of probably one of the worst droughts in living memory at the moment. Where we're standing right now should be not verdantly green, but we shouldn't be able to see our feet for all the grass, to give you an idea of what it should be looking like. We're just making up. Ah, Caroline, all the way from the US, and I'd have to say good morning to you, Caroline. Welcome to the show. You've asked me, what do I have in my first aid kit? Well, Caroline, in my first aid kit, we just carry a breathing and a bleeding trauma kit in our walk first aid kits. So I have a bunch of bandages, many bandage kits, for two reasons. The most dangerous thing that we're likely to encounter out here is an elephant. And the thing that an elephant's going to do if you do happen to run afoul of one is plunge their tusks through your body, in which case no first aid kit on earth is going to help, or throw you around and kick you around a bit, in which case you're going to have a few abrasions and whatnot, and being able to put pressure on a wound almost always stops the bleeding. So even if it's arterial blood coming out, you can put a lot of pressure on that wound, you can get that wound to stop bleeding out, and so we've got a trauma kit for that in my first aid kit. And then the breathing bag, which we carry, is literally just for an allergic reaction to a snake bite. A broken bone, you can get a car here, fall down a hole, whatever the case may be, we can make a plan. But you have an allergic reaction to a snake, you can stop breathing very quickly, and then there you have that breathing bag, pump those lungs full of oxygen, get some help here, get onto a helicopter, off to hospital. On that macabre note, and I hope I answered your question over there, I'm gonna send you over to James, he's got an update for you.
Oh, but I don't have an update for you, everybody. We've fossicked about where the cubs were this morning. They're in, I'm afraid. We're going to give it a go around the side, but I think, that it's so eyes we haven't seen them before, especially the new little ones. And I just don't think we're going to be able to get in there, I'm afraid. They're right in between. You can see the drainage line going up that way. You can see the drainage line going this way. You can see, I don't know if you can see, but there's some tracks from vehicles trying to get in here during the course of this morning. In fact, those are Rusty's tracks. And what they tried to do was stick their heads in here and decide whether they could get the vehicles down through there. Don't fall out. Ooh, Sisyphus on... Sisyphus on the VR rig. Shall we try this, everybody? I think we should. Hold on tight, there's going to be a large bump. We might get... Why not? There we are. Oh, that was relatively easy. And we'll just drive. Think we'd be able to get whether we'll be able to get out or not to be answered. No, we will not be able to get out of here. This is why Jamie rather clever to do precisely what I have just done, especially in Jamie's case. Oh lordy, that was very close. I nearly died, everyone. I hope I feel quite a she's also I nearly stabbed in the back by this thing, David. The wilderness nearly stabbed me in the back. It wasn't very nice of it at all. Hold on tight, everyone. We'll make it out of here, I hope. I was about to stab you in the back, be careful. It's probably the story, the folk tale I told about the hippopotamus that the wilderness is upset with. We should get it. What we're going to do is do one loop around and see if we can't see something from the other side, then I think we'll call it quits. Because she'll bring them out onto the road at some stage, probably not today again, but maybe a little bit later on tonight. And then we'll go and do a loop around and see what else we can see. Come down to Biffleshook Dam. It's been quite a hot day. Any time of the year, really. Which is very heroic of me. Right, while I recover from the wilderness trying to kill me, let's go to Ross, who has found, I think, one of the most amazing things you can get out.
Yes, can you imagine we've managed to re-find this pot that we found during the recent Father's Day shows. I found this pot by accident. We got chased up here by some buffalo and I was standing exactly where my hands are here and I looked down between my legs and lo and behold, found a pot. And it actually has sparked the most amazing to know exactly what it is, but also a debate within the camp with the owner of the company, Mr. Yuri Moorman, and everyone debating whether or what this pot is. Now, there is the pot. You can very clearly see that it's this is the top end of the pot with a bulb here, and then it's got decorations on it, but it's broken. There's a shard there. The pot itself is broken under the pressure of the termite mound. And here's the story that I have. So now, obviously, in days before there were banks, people used to bury their treasures in termite mounds. They used to dig a hole in the termite mound, put their treasures into a pot, and then the termites would cover that hole and would hide the contents of the pot from the naked eye. And of course, only the person who buried it would know where it is. There's also another thing that says that ancestors are appeased by beer being buried into termite mounds to appease the ancestors. So this could have been a beer pot that was. It is unlikely, but it could be that this is a burial ground for a person, that this is a person's buried here. Although that particular theory has been discounted by not only the family that used to live on this piece of land, but also by the owner of the reserve. So this, as far as what we know, is that initially I thought that this pot was up to about 800 years old. And although pottery in this area has been dated at 800 years, these lines here, the decorations on these lines, marketed something in the last 200 years, as far as what I can gather. This is a clay-fired pot, a homemade pot, made pot, because inside there is, I don't know if it's just my eyes, you could perhaps tell me, is that dark? To me, it looks dark. The more I wash it, the darker it gets. And beer pots, needing to be fairly waterproof, were often fired a lot longer than what food pots were, and it gave it this black inside, this burnt inside. They need markers are likely that it is a appeasement beer pot and not something containing, as I've just said to Brian, I think a diamond the size of my fist over here, which I'm hoping it to be. But anyway, we're not going to take the pot out. What we're going to do is leave it in situ for a while. The process now is to find the family members, the elders or the tribe elders of the family that live in this area, and they need to come with me here, and probably the owner of the reserve, to come and see this particular site, and they need to recognize this site as either a burial site, which is unlikely, or then if they say that this may be a treasure pot, then a discussion will be had with the landowner and the people who live on this particular piece of land, the family who are inherently part of this piece of land, and they'll then decide if they leave the pot there or if they take it out. So we're not going to do anything with this pot. In actual fact, I'm going to cover it up as best I can. Try and camouflage. And that's because I don't want anyone to come and dig over there and show disrespect to this piece of pottery that's inside there. Like I said, these things can be relatively sensitive. The last thing we want to do is go step on some cultural toes here. What we do, at least me for instance, I enjoy learning about things but without touching them. All right, and that's that. Glad you got to share that with me, in actual fact. We weren't aiming to aim at this pot, I must be honest, but we did anyway. The area where her tracks were last seen, going in this direction here, while we make it through this little grassland that we've got here, I'm going to send you through to James. He's got an update for you.
Look at this, everybody. We decided to just stick our heads in here and we got very, very, very lucky indeed. Isn't that spectacular? Three little cubbies. And just one tacular. All I saw, everybody, was the just the pom-pom of the mother's tail. Just too wonderful for words. I will now try and take a rank average photograph of them. David, the chances of my getting a photograph at this distance. Ah, yes, not very good. Now, what they are, everybody, is about... Dave, what does the focal distance on that thing say? So they're at 18 meters away from us, just across the drainage line. Very lion cubs. I think they're my favorite kind of little creature, mainly because they make such very nice sounds when they're playing, and they're always playing when they're not asleep or when they haven't been disturbed by a vehicle driving in here. I think they were right in the bottom of this drainage line, and all we saw was the backlit pom-pom of mum's tail there. Isn't this wonderful? I can't believe this. Ah, well. I just wish those cubbies had a Maori. Probably about 3 in 10 females. And of course, at least these guys are born to the... They're the first cubs born to the new coalition. So it's unlikely that the Birmingham boys will be tossed out before these chaps are at least 18 months to 2 years old. It's the ones after that, you know, when those Birmingham boys are reaching the end of their tenure. But because they're young, they may well, you know, hold their territory for longer than the 2.5 to 3 years. But it's the next cubs that would be the ones that are greatest at risk from infanticide. Look, 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 here we go. See how close they're lying to each other? Back a little bit, everyone. Say when. I'll just leave the engine running. How's that? Perfect. I haven't seen lion cubs, everyone, since the Styx Pride cubs, who were subsequently murdered by the marauding Birmingham boys. It's totally typical, of course. And these are my first ones then. Oh, Dave, I think that's a lovely shot of the mum there. And which, do we know which Nkuhuma lioness this is? Which the one, it's the one with the longish face, isn't it? Saying to me too. I'm very bad with my identification. Yes, it is. So I know our signal. Let's try and sex them as well. We can try and find out what they are. That looks like a little female. Yeah, Kathy, I noticed this with those two leopard cubs. You say even at this age, their paws are huge. They are. They are probably already pretty much the size of Karula's cubs, at least Karula's tracks. And, I mean, they are now, what, 6 weeks old, maybe? Look at them biting each other. I think our nest that we're looking at there, from what I can see behind her tail. Definitely. A bit like this, everybody, and then when you next go across to Steph, I'll just see if I can't get around, but this is a pretty good view. Abhishek, nice question from you, and I'll give you a nice easy way to remember it. It's you want to know when they're going to wean, basically, when they'll stop doing which they're doing now. It's an easy one to remember because it's 6, 6, and 6 as far as I remember. 6 days until they open their eyes from birth, if I'm not mistaken, 6 weeks until they're introduced to the pride, 6 months until they start to wean. That's how I've always remembered it. Now, I wonder if this wouldn't be an opportune moment to try and get another view. Virginia, you say the cub at the back looks quite a lot larger than the other two. No, Virginia, I don't. I'm 90% sure that they are almost identically in identical in size. Look at that. And I think the only reason they look slightly different, I think it's probably a perspective thing. It is possible that there's a male cub and he's slightly bigger than the others. But you know, at this age, much like with human beings, you know, they're not much smaller than they. At least they're not really different sizes. Spend all afternoon here, I'm afraid, because there's a great deal of activity on the reserve, so we're going to stay here for as long as we can. Yeah, we're going to try and get, see if I can check the map and see exactly where we are. And then we'll decide if we can move or not. Looks exhausted, as most mothers do, you know, after looking after 3 children. There we go, I found us. Yeah, I see, this is interesting. I think to get to the other side of that drainage line, we'd have to come in from Warri Pan Road, which is a road quite far from here. Right, I've made a view. I'm going to suggest we go around. Paul, that's one of the major reasons lions roar, is to contact each other. And so she will just roar loudly, and the others will roar. Well,
alrighty, James is just repositioning and trying to reposition on those beautiful lion cubs that you're so lucky to see, and trying to find some signal. Well, we've come into, I promise you, I've never been into this particular area before. This is a brand new place for me at Juma. As far back through the trees, have a look at that, all the way through the trees there in the distance are these mounds of sand, and I don't actually know Warren of an aardvark colony, probably spanning, from the looks of things, several hundred years. But quite often aardvark will come into areas like this of deep sand on top of these crests, and their tunnels will collapse underneath the weight of the roof. And so what happens is you get these aardvark making tunnels. They're strong enough to dig themselves out right here, and these in a vehicle be like minefields. You drive your car over things like this and you go into one of these holes. Not easy to get out. Now this is a collapsed one. I would actually be in that depression right here, and then the exit tunnel would have been there. So aardvark burrows can quite often have more than one entry and exit. They use it to get away, and I think that we just seen the sort of ox. Okay, so it caught me on. We got a spider web on the lens. We're just going to clean it off for you. Part of our jumping spider's anchor line. Let's carry on with this exploring. It's actually phenomenal. Have a look at the sand that's been excavated here. Have a look at this pile of sand that's been excavated out of this thing. At least a foot. Now you're standing at the top of it. You've got another foot underneath where you are at the moment. And then here we've got some more. And there looks like a fresh one right there. And throw it in there, because quite often warthog love to live inside these things. And what I don't want is a warthog to come shooting out of that burrow and think I'm the cause of its stress, because quite often they come out and slash with their tusks, those big teeth that come out of there. You don't want to be standing anywhere close to that. So let's approach with caution. You can actually see. Have a look. Yes. And this is definitely the freshest of all of them here. Come here and come and have a look at what's... You won't be able to see the aardvark, of course, but have a look at this mountain of loose sand. This is the sand that makes up the crests. Have a look down there. And we've actually got an aardvark in residence. And I'm going to show you how I know that. On the right-hand side wall of this particular warren is a fly. Now, if you look inside there, you'll see these big, fat flies on the right-hand side there. There, you got them. Go in to the right. Up a little bit, there. Just in the little bit, there, you've got two of them. Now those flies suck the blood on aardvarks. And I'm almost sure that those flies would be so specific to just the aardvarks in this area by the blood that they carry inside of them. So what the aardvark does is he goes inside there, the flies know that if the tunnel collapses on the aardvark, they'd be stuck. So they wait at the entrance. They wait at the entrance for the aardvark to come out. And the aardvark comes out in the dark. And then they jump on top of the aardvark again. And they spend the evening sucking its blood and foraging with it. And that's how you know an aardvark is in residence. So I know there's an aardvark inside of this tunnel. Isn't that amazing? I'd probably stick my head inside over there if I had a head torch on. What you don't want to do is go in there with no light on, because quite often these holes are also inhabited by porcupines. As you all know, porcupine running at my face inside of there in the dark, not going to be very friendly with me, and don't want to stick my head in there. But I'm fairly certain that there's an aardvark inside there. Isn't this just wonderful? And probably generations of this aardvark, I don't know, decades, who knows? Just lots and lots and lots of things here. Let's go and have a look over there at that hole there and see what we can find. Just such an interesting place. Gracie, age 8, has asked me if animals would eat that type of treasure that I found. I presume you are talking about the flies that we found in the bottom of this thing. Gracie, no. Oh, the pot. Excuse me, the pot of treasure. Excuse me, Gracie. It depends on what was kept in it, you know. What is one person's treasure is another man's junk, or however that saying goes. I'm sure Brian is wanting to correct me over there, but it goes something like that. So it doesn't treasures of your own, you want to keep them safe, or you maybe want to savor the memory around them. I'm not too sure. And that's what could be in that pot that we found there, someone's treasure, quite easily so. It doesn't necessarily have to be diamonds and gold, although that's all I'm really hoping for inside there. Right, and here we have the other side of that tunnel. This one's collapsed. This is a termite mound. So now we know why the aardvark was here, and that this is where he's getting some food from. This must be a massive harvested termite colony. And over here, you can see that there are old excavations, even here amongst the monkey thorn trees, even down there. Just wherever I'm looking, I'm just seeing these mounds of sand. Very interesting. An aardvark community, ant bear community. Oh, James Richards, you're asking me some questions over here, and I'm gonna try and guess at them. James Richard has asked me about how many babies aardvark have. Are they altricial? Are they precocial? Good question there. I don't see aardvark enough to retain that type of knowledge. I'm sure I used to know it at some point in my junior guiding career 20 years ago. I haven't had to recall that fact since those days. So what I'll do, and anyone else who doesn't know, you're welcome to send the answers to questions@wildearth.tv using the emails or the hashtag Safari Live, and I'll see if I can share it with you between the end of, or between now and the end of drive. So the question is, how many babies do aardvark have? And are they born precocial or altricial? In other words, are they born blind and helpless, or able to join their parents from straight after birth? I would imagine that with holes like this, they would probably be born blind and helpless. Watch out for the branch. Blind and helpless. And I would imagine because they're born blind and helpless, assume that there are anywhere from 2 to 4, maybe up to 6 little babies. 2 to 4, maybe up to 6 little babies born altricial. And that is what I would probably also inhabited. Doesn't look like it's inhabited as fresh as that other one, because you can see that there's a lot of leaves here. But along the right-hand side there, you can see that there's definitely a tunnel. Roger's just asked me if we can see an aardvark track. And you know, Roger, I've been looking, since I got here, I've been looking into the sand. An aardvark has got 3 toes. Just like that is what it would look like with some nails in the front. That's what an aardvark track would look like. But today, so windy, have a look what would happen. This aardvark came into these holes literally last night at around about 3-4 o'clock. The whole day's been windy. Look what happens to work with. Not much. So I've been waiting to see if I can get you a track here. I haven't seen any. And it's we'll get there eventually. I just need to find myself some finer dust to show you one at some point. What's telling me that it's aardvark is the fact that there are so many excavations. The fact that we saw those little blood-sucking flies at the entrance to one of them will do this. Only aardvark do this. We're going to try and wind our way through here. Quite an overactive imagination that imagines my femoral artery being cut off by slashing tusks. And because I have this picture in my mind, I stay well. So no, I have had a cave growl at me. That was probably the scariest cave experience I've ever had. I stuck my head into a cave without announcing myself with a loud voice and throwing a stick. And the cave, this darkness, basically growled at me with a very deep bassy growl. To this day, I still don't know what it is. I don't really want to know what it is. And it cemented my caution quite firmly. Brian, you've asked me, do aardvark run away or do they stand their ground when frightened? So I've seen aardvark twice in 20 years. The first time I saw an aardvark was for 5 minutes, and he was ambling along at a shuffle because he was on a tar road and we were in a car behind him. And I'm sure his shadow and our lights and the noise of the car were bothering him. He was shuffling, not standing his ground, but also not running away panicked. The second time I saw an aardvark was luckily on foot in the Kalahari Desert, which is on the western side of South Africa. And we were lucky enough, it was midwinter, it was quite cold for them. And we were lucky enough to see him from far away. The wind was blowing and we snuck up on this aardvark. And I spent an hour watching this aardvark, digging for termites and snuffing around, completely oblivious to us being there. So I can't actually answer your question. They are relatively big. We're looking at about 80 pounds for a very, very big and double the thickness. They're relatively big with massive claws on its front legs that it can use to dig with, and a big tail. They've got a tail that's probably about this thick and about this long that they can whip around. The tail itself not going to do anything, but those digging claws and those very powerful arms for digging into the sand. Reputation here for devouring aardvark. He's obviously knows that he can follow one, and with a bit of a struggle he can get one that provides him with a lot of meat. Now they just eat termites and ants. In actual fact, they are the they're probably one of the world's largest termite eating animals. They only eat termites. And anyway, but that's on that. We're going to kick ourselves into low gear here to get through here without sinking Brian neck deep into one of these holes with his backpack on. And James has managed to reposition himself, so you're off to the cubs. Enjoy.
Reposition, everybody, is a great understatement for what we've done. And the cubs are now in the sunlight. We can see them there. Quite hairy driving, to be honest. They're there in the middle of the thicket there. And I think we're going to sit here for a little while and see if we can't get a nice view. There's Mum. Mum is not looking at us anymore. She has no care about what we are doing. The cubbies are just to the left-hand side of her. Just... Now they've gone behind that termite mound. Have you got one there? There we go. I think it's going to be worth sitting here, everyone. You know what? we probably would have had just as good a view. I thought we'd better try and have a look from here, especially as if they come into the sun from here. Well, then we'll have a real show. So I think we'll just wait here for a little while. Hello, Gracie. You're just 8, of course. You must be nearly 9 by now. Gracie, you say, do these cubbies stay with their mama all the time? Yes, they do, Gracie, until the males are about 2.5, then, like Junior, they get thrown out of the home. They have to go and look after themselves. But the cubs, the female cubs, will stay with their mum forever and ever. Go ahead, Ev. I've just arrived here, and I've relocated on the southern side of the drainage. I don't think you're going to get your car in here. I think your best bet is to go off central and follow the tracks in there. I think you'll get a view from, if you just follow those tracks in, I think you'll get a view from central. So make your way, yeah, make your way in on those tracks. Isn't that fantastic? Oh, fantastic. Ah, wow. I mean, towards this area, everyone. Oh, there we go. This is what, that's what I was hoping for. Come on, lift your head up again. Let me take a rank average photograph so that David can crit my efforts. This is fantastic. Isn't it just amazing, everyone? This time with little animals like this, they're obviously suckling. It would be best if she turned round, of course. But we'll make do. Aqua, nice question from you, and there are two answers to it. The first, well, your question, first of all, is do they acclimatize better? They don't seem to become more habituated to the vehicles more quickly because their parents are. You see, the mothers are absolutely, completely habituated to us. And so they will habituate quickly. But it's also that they haven't, this is not the first time they've seen cars. They've seen plenty of vehicles. Remember, they've been on Torchwood for some time. And she was in a... She was in a position where the vehicles used to view them, you know, viewed them extensively. And so this is not their first rodeo, as it were, cue from their mother. And so as long as their mother is not panicked by us, so they will stay completely relaxed. Ah, what a joy. Hey? Stiff falling in termite mounds and aardvark burrows. Here we are with lion cubs. 26 degrees Celsius, gentle wind from the north. Gosh, it's just a marvellous, marvellous day. Hello, Lily. You're also aged just 8. I wonder if you too are about to be 9. Lily, you want to know, you're in New Mexico, which is different from Ohio. You want to know when mum will start taking them to the kills. Well, pretty soon, you know, from about 3 months, they'll picture. And that's to hide them. And listen, they're starting to make noises. So Lily, from about 3 months, she'll start to take them to, well, in fact, even earlier. 6 weeks, she introduces them to the pride. And from then, they may or may not go towards the kills, but probably not. In 3 months, definitely, they'll be eating meat. Look at those spots, just like a leopard spots to start with, and they all fade with time. Obviously missed that photographic opportunity. Oh, look. So you say to the lions, listen to them. You say, do the lion cubs come into the world one after the other, or is there a sort of rest between them as they're born? I don't think there's much of a rest, no. I think she gives birth pretty much one after the other. And they are suckling now very, very actively. It should play, isn't it? Very, very lucky we are. I don't actually think we would be seeing them from the other side. I think they'd be behind this bush and obviously their heads completely turned away from us. At least we've got some ears now. And spots. I love the sound lion cubs make. They make this sort of, I know you can't hear them at the moment, they go, ow, 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 ow. You'll just have to take my word for it for now. Yeah, I can't get any closer than this. Well, I probably could. Davey, large stump there. Jonathan, yes. The answer to your question is, you want to know if those spots that you can so very clearly see there are a defensive mechanism against them, you know, against predators and things during their early years, or not their early years, their early months. Absolutely. You know that a leopard has got spots so that it can hide by the drainage lines under the shade and be almost invisible. But when they're big, you see, there's no point in them maintaining those markings, because they're so big and obvious that the best thing for them to be is that tawny colour, especially in the winter time. It's the perfect winter colour for them to be. Just a little ear or two there. You can see that's Dave's shadow there. That is. I'm going to give them another 3 minutes and then I'm going to try and move slightly. I don't think we're going to get a better view than this, though, everyone. But we might be able to lighten them and make them go off into the drainage line, because then the game will be up. She looks pretty well fed to me, so I wonder if she didn't go off last night and have a feed. But they're very contentedly having a suckle. She's lifting her head now. Do you want to know what my nicknames for these beautiful cubs are going to be? Well, Janet, I don't know. I haven't managed to sex them yet. We've got one lioness. Maybe we should name them after, if they're all girls, I think we should name them after the girls in the final control. No, we won't do that. Maybe we should, actually. If they're three lionesses, that's definitely what I'm going to call them. But if they're not, I don't know. I think we need some gangster names. Lions, for me, are not the royalty of the bush. For me, lions are the gangsters of the bush. So if there's a male, we'll call it Al. And females? Female gangsters, Dave? Can you think of any? On that drainage line today. They're not fueled by idiocy like I am. Okay, I think we're going to try a little maneuver here. We're going to do it very subtly as we can in this car. Ah, I see I have a pimple. There we are. Okay, my pimple's gone, everybody. Magic. We're going to just ease our way around there like that. Come and look at them. I don't think he's going to get those big Land Cruisers in here. You know, that's the one advantage of having a small car like this. There are no other advantages, but it's the one advantage of having these Land Rovers, is that they are littler than the other cars. And that means we can get into areas where they, you drive them through a knobthorn tree. I've just got David, and he doesn't squeal, he just grunts. It's going to be a little bit of a maneuver, this. We'll hit something now. Are you ready? Bump. You Brian, very nice question from you. When I try and sneak around here, I'm just going to watch her behavior, see that she isn't threatened by my activity here. The cubs are looking up. Brian, sorry my girl, I won't be long, I'll shut up. Unfortunately, my maneuver has taken the sun off them, but that's okay. So Brian, you want to know if the Birminghams have cubs with other prides, like the Styx pride, will they eventually form one consolidated pride? No, absolutely not, they won't. They don't do that. Lions, they are not related to the Styx pride, or not very closely, and they don't meet up like that. They don't have a situation where they are able to sort of make a giant pride. It's very unusual. And in this area, 3 to 5 lionesses is the optimum sort of size for a lion pride to be. And so that's basically what happens. And the Birminghams, remember, are not ever part of the pride. No male is part of the pride once he's left. So like Junior was here until he was about 3 and a half. And he was part of the pride, but that was his natal pride. He's now left this pride. He's formed a little coalition. And he will no longer be part of a pride. He's now part of a coalition, and he will dominate. Hopefully one day he will have two or three prides that he looks after, and that's basically how it works. So the adults are not part of the pride. The males are not part of the pride. Now, if you want to be slightly amused, you can see what I mean here. Here comes Ephraim, and Ephraim's guests have now got thorns hanging from just about every piece of their heads. F, stop there, go backwards. I can see him, he can't see us. Back a bit more. Yeah, now you need to head basically, if you look to your western side, straight into the sun, you'll see me. And you need to make your way basically straight towards me if you can, and you'll get a view from the other side of the drainage. Yeah, I'm waving at you. Okay, yeah.